morning, and welcome to our Zoom worship service. I am Tina Hilding, and I'll be your celebrant this morning. I'd like to extend a special welcome to all those who are here worshiping with us for the first time. We're so very glad that you're here. If you've come in person, you should have received a welcome packet when you arrived. It's got a card in it. If you fill that out and drop it in the offering basket, we will be able to be in touch to support you in finding your way into our community. In the meantime, please join us in our fellowship hall downstairs following the service for coffee. Our welcoming committee members have yellow name tags and are happy to answer any questions or point you toward additional information. If you're joining us online, there's a link on our website to an electronic version of that same card. And we host a virtual coffee hour after the service if there's any interest. So no need to log off right away. And now, let's say our words of welcome together. Welcome to you, old friends and new, young and old. You are an essential part of our celebration today. Whether today is your first or your thousandth in our midst, we are stronger because you are with us. We are one people of many beliefs, identities, origins, sexualities, and genders. We are all growing, all learning, all loved. Body, mind, heart, and spirit. Just as you are welcome here. Now we will take a moment to say hello across the technical divide. First, we're going to show the people joining us on Zoom. If you are at home, please turn on your camera. Now, people at home, wave.
Hello.
Now, people who are attending the service in our building, it's your turn to wave. I do have a few announcements this morning. We are hoping to have a congregation-wide conversation next month. We want to know how you're doing, how connected to the church community you feel, and what you think our priorities should be moving forward. These are big questions, but we will answer them in small gatherings over dinner. Please be on the lookout for a sign-up genius with several circle supper options. Our hope is that everyone will sign up. Elizabeth Berlinger and Martha Schmidt will be available during coffee hour with their laptops to help you sign up if you would like. And that's the end of our announcements. And we preface our service by acknowledging that the land on which our homes and our church were built was not inhabited when European settlers arrived here with their ideas of conquest and ownership. For those of us who live in Moscow, Pullman, or other nearby communities, we live on the ancestral homes of the Niyamipu, called Nez Perce by the French-speaking traders, the Palouse, and the Chichumps, called the Coeur d'Alene. If you are joining us from another place, I encourage you to discover who inhabited or moved through the place where you now live in the times before colonization and genocide and where they are now. We pause and remember that we live on ground that is sacred, ground that was stolen, ground that cries out for justice and for responsible stewardship. May our remembering help us find the courage to do our part to restore wholeness to the earth and all her peoples. And we'll have a special candle for peace. We also pause for just a moment to light a candle and pray for peace. We hold in our hearts all those currently threatened by greed and imperialism, from the people in Ukraine to those in Burma and Somalia. May we recommit ourselves to nurturing peace, peace in the world, and peace within. And the chalice lighting and some affirmation. We're hoping that folks joining us via Zoom have a chalice or a candle to light and something to light it with. Let's light our chalices together. In the light of truth and the warmth of love,
everyone. I am the Reverend Dr. Elizabeth Stevens, and I am lucky enough to serve this congregation as its minister. Now, most of us, well, let me just ask this. How many of you enjoy being wrong? Making mistakes? Okay. So, most of us don't particularly enjoy being wrong or making mistakes, but we are human. And this means that we are often wrong. We make mistakes all the time. But because being wrong feels unpleasant, sometimes we find ourselves reluctant to own our full humanity. We cling to an illusion of rightness and turn a blind eye to anything that challenges the models that exist in our brains about the world and the way it works. So today's service is going to explore being wrong as a spiritual practice. Now, what do I mean by that? I'm just assuming that we all know what it means to be wrong. But when it comes to spiritual practice, I'm in a program to become certified as a spiritual director, and we were given what I think is a really good definition of spiritual practice. It is anything that we do with attention, intention, and repetition. So a spiritual practice is any practice to which we bring intention, attention, and repetition. So if we were to embrace a discipline of regularly, intentionally, and attentively making mistakes and getting things wrong, what does that do for us? Well, we cultivate humility and we cultivate authenticity. More than that, this practice opens our way to learning, change, creativity, and healing. Or at least that's the theory. I might be wrong. Let's sing together now, number 1012, When I Am Frightened. Please be seated, and I'd like to invite the children forward. We have a story to share.
Now let's take a moment to engage in the practice of generosity together. For those of you able to make a financial contribution, the logistics are on your screen. We'd invite you to either copy down the information you need or simply go to the website to make a donation. The web address is in the chat. Those of you who are newer or visiting from another part of the country may not be aware that we typically give away all the cash from our Sunday offering to local charities whose missions align with our values, a program called the Month of Sundays. And we actually have a check to present to last month's recipient. I'd like to invite Mary Jo Hamilton forward to present the check.
Hi. You've all known about the Month of Sundays, and we've continued making our donations of Month of Sundays through all the time that we were away from church because of the construction of COVID. But we're going back to something we've not been able to do for a long time. We are going to present our check today in person. So if Autumn would come up, please. Autumn Avery is the executive director of the Family Promise of the Palouse. Family Promise of the Palouse was our September recipient of the Month Sundays donation, and we were able to collect $2,900.42 for Family Promise.
Not just with your financial contributions, but your volunteerism and the fact that we get to start being in your center again. It's wonderful as well. I'm blown away. Thank you very much. We have been incredibly busy and we're just getting busier, and our community comes together and it's wonderful. So thank you for being a part of that.
I just want to say that we will be back doing Family Promise in person in our church on January.
This month, the recipient of the Month of Sundays is Planned Parenthood in Pullman. Planned Parenthood's mission is to provide a high-quality, inclusive, and comprehensive sexual and reproductive health care services to all people, all people need and deserve, with respect and compassion. If you're donating online, you can choose Month of Sundays from the drop-down menu, and if you're mailing or dropping off a check, simply indicate in the memo line whether it is intended for the Month of Sundays or our general fund. In the spirit of love and for the continuing work of this church, we will now take some time to practice generosity together.
Thank you.
just a little deeper in this, into the spirit of meditation or prayer. This is a piece called Let Astonishment Be Possible by my colleague, the Reverend Gretchen Haley. Whatever you've come in anticipating, whatever you expect or worry for our world, for the future, for our lives, let it go. Make space in your heart to be surprised. Make room in your soul for a new story to take shape. Let astonishment be possible at this life that remains a miracle. Imagine here the bursting of joy, relentless and resilient, coming in waves, washing over us with music and story, silence and still, this dreaming together, being hope for each other, and courage to believe in this new day dawning for us all. Let's rest in the silence together. Our reading this morning comes from a great book, one I recommend highly. It's called Being Wrong, Adventures in the Margin of Error by Catherine Schultz. A whole lot of us go through life assuming that we are basically right, basically all the time, about basically everything, about our political and intellectual convictions, our religious and moral beliefs, our assessment of other people, our memories, our grasp of facts. As absurd as it sounds when we stop to think about it, our steady state seems to be one of unconsciously assuming that we are very close to omniscient. In our collective imagination, error is associated not just with shame and stupidity, but also with ignorance, indolence, psychopathology, and moral degeneracy. In this rather despairing view, and it is the common one, our errors are evidence of our gravest social, intellectual, and moral failings. Of all the things we are wrong about, this idea of error might well top the list. It is our meta mistake. We are wrong about what it means to be wrong. Far from being a sign of intellectual inferiority, the capacity to err is crucial to human cognition. Far from being a moral flaw, it is inextricable from some of our most humane and honorable qualities: empathy, optimism, imagination, conviction, and courage. And far from being a mark of indifference or intolerance, wrongness is a vital part of how we learn and change. However disorienting, difficult, or humbling our mistakes might be, it is ultimately wrongness, not rightness, that can teach us who we are. So, how many of you think that there's an objective reality? All right, and how many of us think that we actually have a pretty good grasp of objective reality? So, what if I tell you that the data, because we love data, seems to say otherwise? Now, it doesn't say that there isn't an objective reality. Objective reality probably is, although we maybe can't prove it. But the book from which I excerpted our opening and closing reading, Being Wrong, Adventures in the Margin of Error by Catherine Schultz, details a myriad of studies that demonstrate not only do we experience reality only after it's been filtered through our mental models, but that for the most part, we tend not to be aware that those mental models exist. In other words, there's reality and we experience that reality through our senses, but as the sensory input is integrated into our brain, into our neural networks, it becomes demonstrably corrupted. And we don't even realize that this is happening. Now, for example, Schultz cites one study where people wrote down what they were doing when they first heard about the terrorist attack of 9/11, they wrote it down immediately afterwards. So this is the account, this is what I was doing when I got the news. And then 3 years later, they were asked to do it again. Now, in both cases, the one right after and the one 3 years later, they shared very intense and detailed accounts of exactly what they were doing when they got the news. They were positive that they remembered exactly what they were doing when they got the news. But then they were invited to compare the accounts that they wrote down. And those two accounts, in the vast majority of cases, were completely and totally different from one another. The interesting piece for me, though, is that rather than accepting that their current, intense, clear, exact memories might be wrong, the study participants found all kinds of bizarre justifications for the differences between the two accounts. One woman was convinced that someone else must have written this original account, even though she recognized her very own handwriting. So this is our dilemma. Not only do we often get things wrong as we integrate information into our cognitive understandings, we rarely, if ever, are aware that we are getting things wrong. It doesn't feel like we're making a mistake or storing corrupted data. It feels like we are correctly and accurately capturing and cataloging objective reality. It goes against our lived experience to acknowledge our own fallibility. As Schultz puts it, we love to know things, but ultimately we can't know for sure that we know them. We are bad at recognizing when we don't know something, and we are very, very good at making stuff up. She continues, although we are highly adept at making models of the world, we are distinctly less adept at realizing we have made them. And here is where the spiritual practice part comes in. We can, with attention, intention, and repetition, learn to embrace our own fallibility. Now, Unitarian Universalists, for the most part, tend to be curious people. We value learning and growing. It's right there in the third and fourth principles. We affirm and promote acceptance of one another and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations. And we affirm and promote a free and responsible search for truth and meaning. Some, though not all, of us have a scientific bent. We like to stay abreast of research developments. Inherent in a healthy respect for what we've come to understand through observation, hypothesis, and experimentation is the underlying awareness of how much we don't. Schultz asserts that the scientific method is essentially a monument to the utility of error. A monument to the utility of error. She continues, scientists gravitate toward falsification. As a community, if not as individuals, they seek to disprove their beliefs and theories. Thus, the defining feature of a hypothesis is that it has the potential to be proven wrong, which is why it must be both testable and tested. And the defining feature of a theory is that it hasn't been proven wrong yet. But the important part is that it can be, no matter how much evidence appears to confirm it, no matter how many experts endorse it, no matter how much popular support it enjoys. In fact, not only can any given theory be proven wrong sooner or later, it probably will be. And when it is, the occasion will mark the success of science, not its failure. When we generalize this approach to the rest of life, we see the importance of doubt. I share, I know, with some regularity, the catchphrase that my seminary professor gave to us when talking about any substantive or religious or theological questions, that the best we can hope for are answers that are somewhat adequate for now. I usually add one more caveat. These answers are somewhat adequate for me for now. So in our exploration, it behooves us to be savvy consumers of information. I remember a class that I took as an undergraduate on media ethics. The chief takeaway was that while journalistic integrity requires holding the goal of providing a fair and balanced account, it's actually literally impossible to reach that goal. Knowing that the media industrial complex is more focused on making money than on providing accurate information, we need to take everything we read or watch with a grain of salt. So we can bring an attitude of healthy doubt to the information coming in, and we can bring an attitude of healthy doubt to the conclusions we draw that are based on that information as well. We, as consumers of media, are highly subject to confirmation bias. I've done a whole service on this one before. What it means is that we're much more likely to seek out, ingest, and believe information that reinforces our existing beliefs. Now, we can try to broaden our perspective by deliberately pushing the edges. For years, I subscribed to the Wall Street Journal in hopes of better understanding fiscal conservatives, and it did help some. But as we get further out into material that contradicts our existing mental models, we discover an almost infinite capacity to dismiss anything that makes us question ourselves. Now, I would never suggest that we abandon the attempt to base our worldviews on objective reality. I wouldn't advise any of you to just go dive into QAnon or Fox News. But I would suggest that people who have done that, who have gone down a rabbit hole, who believe things that seem ludicrous to you or to I, are not stupid or crazy or ignorant. They've constructed a different mental model, one that makes sense of the data they are ingesting. And as such, arguing with them is unlikely to be effective. So what can we do? We can listen with curiosity. We can try to understand their mental model. And perhaps from within that model, we can ask questions or introduce a slightly different perspective. We can pay more attention to feelings and to stories. We can hold our so-called facts a little bit more lightly. We can choose the relationship over our own sense of being right. I have an aunt and uncle who watch nothing but Fox News, and I had to unfriend and block them on social media because they were posting things that I found offensive, both on their pages and as comments on my stuff. But when we're together in person, it turns out we still have a warm and loving relationship. We share a lot of history and many core values. So that part of me that thinks that I have a firm grasp on the truth and that they drank the Kool-Aid isn't the part that I'm going to center in our relationship, because there's a deeper part of me that knows that they are fundamentally good people and that if push came to shove, they would show up for me if I needed them. So what makes this possible is the perspective that as comfortable as I am in my own worldview, I'm almost certainly wrong about some of it, maybe a lot of it. Intellectual humility makes room for authentic connection and compassion. Schultz writes, "To be judgmental, we must feel sure that we know right from wrong and that we ourselves would never confuse the two. But the experience of erring shows us otherwise. It reminds us that having been wrong in the past, we could easily be wrong again. And not just in the abstract, but right now, here in the middle of this argument about pickles or constellations or crumb cake. At the same time, it reminds us to treat other people with compassion, to honor them in their possible rightness as well as their inevitable occasional wrongness. Instead of taking their errors as a sign that they are ignorant or evil, we can look to our own lives and reach the opposite conclusion that they are, like us, just human." If we want to get closer to understanding objective reality, we need to be willing to question our mental maps and beliefs. We need to be more committed to change, growth, and evolution than we are to defending our positions. We need to embrace our own fallibility. We need to accept that a lot of the time, as human beings, we just get things wrong. In Zen Buddhism, there's a concept known as shoshaku jushaku. Shako generally means mistake or wrong. Shoshaku jushaku then means to succeed wrong with wrong, or one continuous mistake. The best we might hope for is to become over time a little less wrong than we were before, acknowledging that human nature is such that we'll never get it all the way right. It's actually sort of liberating, isn't it? Schultz writes, "When it comes to our own notably non-abstract selves, we tend to operate under the assumption that we know who we are and that we will be the same person tomorrow as we are today. One of the most formidable powers of wrongness is to challenge this assumption, because it can entail renouncing central aspects of the person we always thought we were and becoming someone we never imagined we would be. The experience of error shows us our own self as both occluded and in flux." In other words, being wrong as a spiritual practice is a brave and transformative path. At a time like this one, when so much of our world is in flux, when so many of the structures we've counted on are crumbling up before our eyes, life is demanding that we find new ways of being human. And the only way to do that is through trial and error. Now, we all have moments when something we're doing, a pattern we followed for a long time, or an understanding we've relied on, when those things stop working, right? We've all experienced that. So one choice is to cling, to keep doing what we always did, and if we don't get the desired result, to blame other people or circumstances outside our control. But the other, more courageous choice is to let go and say, okay, I thought this was my way of being human, but I guess I was wrong. Then we try something different. And maybe it works better, and maybe it doesn't, but we just assume that we're still getting it wrong, so we keep on trying until we find a new pattern or understanding that works. That's somewhat adequate for me for now. It's a much slower path to enlightenment than we might have imagined. But if you read the spiritual literature, stories of instantaneous transformation are few and far between. We might tell this story in such a way that it has drama and progresses logically, but the reality of personal and spiritual growth is more often this very messy, two steps forward, one step back, achingly slow unfolding as we asymptotically approach our optimum way of being us, somewhat adequate for me for now. Lenny Bruce once joked, "I know my humor is outrageous when it makes the Unitarians so mad that they burn a question mark on my front lawn." That question mark, which is arguably as important a symbol for our faith as the flaming chalice, symbolizes our collective commitment to uncertainty and doubt and discernment, continual discernment. It may be, ironically, that always questioning and always being open to the possibility that we may be wrong is one thing that we as Unitarian Universalists get right. Like the story of the blind men and the elephant, we're able to admit that the best we can hope for is to get a hold of some small and slippery piece of the truth. And that if we're able to wrap together all of our different perspectives, only then might we even begin to guess at the shape of the whole. We all, in some deep and primal place, recognize that our mental models are a pretty fragile and fallible shield against the overwhelming complexity that is objective reality. So we're stuck in this predicament where there's no way we can accurately and adequately understand reality, and at the same time, we have to understand reality in order to function. So to embrace the spiritual practice of being wrong is to hold these two truths simultaneously, one in each hand, and to move forward as best we can together. So be it, and so may it be. I invite you now to rise in body, spirit, or voice and join in singing our closing hymn, number 1021, Lean on Me.
Thank you.
closing reading is from Being Wrong, Adventures in Margin of Error. Error, even though it sometimes feels like despair, is actually much closer in spirit to hope. We get things wrong because we have an enduring confidence in our minds, and we face up to that wrongness in the faith that having learned something, we will get it right the next time. In this optimistic vein, embracing our fallibility is simply a way of paying homage to, in the words of late philosopher Richard Rorty, the permanent possibility of someone having a better idea. The great advantage of realizing that we have told a story about the world is realizing that we can tell a better one, rich with better ideas, better possibilities, even perhaps better people.
Go forth then, and don't be afraid of being wrong. It's just what we do. And then the other things that we do. We love, we share, we support one another, we keep on moving forward. Don't forget to vote. Go in peace. Come back in love.